But make no mistakes about it, the Bible does teach us a lot about how God is angry with our sins and how God will condemn men who remain in their sins, who remain in their unbelief. In fact, I think one of the first things God said in the Garden of Eden is this: thou shalt not eat of the fruit thereof, for in the day thou shalt eat of it, you shall surely die. God means business. The idea of a Santa Claus is so erroneous. God is no Santa Claus. God is not a grumpy, indulgent old man sitting up there. He's the God of the heavens who is holy and righteous. And there's the wrath of God poured out against sin and against sinful men. The Bible tells us, but after your hardness and impenitent heart, you treasure up unto yourself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. So, let's be clear. There is condemnation, plenty of it found in the Bible. God does condemn sinful men who remain in unbelief and in their sins. But all that turned around when Jesus came, isn't it? The Bible tells us, Jesus, his very own words, verily, verily, in John 5:24, verily, verily, I say unto thee, he that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. When we are in Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation. But when you are outside of Jesus Christ, when you are out of Christ, you face condemnation. So in the light of such scary, thunderous fury of the Lord, Romans 8 and verse 1 is a sweet ringing tone to our ears. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. You are forever loved, forever accepted in Christ. You are eternally pardoned, your sins are forgiven, and God will not bring it against you anymore. Do you know how absolute it is? It is as absolute as God is absolute. It's all in Christ, you see. I want you to turn your Bibles, I did not put it up on screen, to Romans 8 and verses 33 onwards. I mean, these are words that you need to read to yourself constantly. Remind yourself of what God says. Because in times where you go through difficulties, when you are discouraged, when you feel you have failed the Lord, you got to go to the truth. You got to go and find out what God is saying about you. He says in Romans 8 and verse 33, great text, this is glorious song of praise almost. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. He's saying, who can condemn you if God has declared you righteous? Wow! Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. He goes on, verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Love of Christ, shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Can all these things ever separate us from the eternal love of God? No. Look at verse 37. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, nothing at all, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, the strong love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. Eternally loved, forever forgiven, perpetually pardoned. This is your position in Christ. This is what Paul is saying. There is therefore now no condemnation. Wow. You see, what kind of condemnation? What is condemnation? Well, let's be exact. Let's be precise, because the Bible is precise. The word condemnation in the Greek is the word called katakrima. It's a specific word. This refers to the sentencing and to the punishment. So two parts to it. First of all, the pronouncement that you're guilty, and number two, the punishment or the penalty that your guilt deserves or your crime deserves. So it's a bigger word that includes both the sentencing and the punishment. Now this is a word that is used rarely in scriptures, just three times, and it all happens in the book of Romans. But in the Greek, there's another word that is used for judgment or condemnation, and that is the word katakrino. It's a different word. And that word refers only to the sentencing. It doesn't deal with the judge, it doesn't deal with the punishment or the penalty. So Paul is precise. He says, if you are in Christ Jesus, there is no katakrima. There is no sentencing that you are guilty. God doesn't look at you as guilty, and you will not be punished for your sins. Hold your horses. If you are confused, I will explain it in due time, but let's be understanding the word katakrima. There is no sentencing, and there will be no punishment for your sins. Well, some Christians are getting uneasy already. No punishment, Pastor. Yes, no punishment. But I'll tell you a little bit more in a while. So that's what Scripture is saying. If you are in Christ, no more guilty, no more punishment. And for the absoluteness of this, Paul uses a word that is unique to represent the word no. The second word you need to look at is the word no, udes. This no is not a simple no. It's a strong no. It's a very strong negative tone to it. In other words, it means no, not at all, never. So if you read this verse, it says there will be never, no, not at all, any sentencing nor punishment for your sins to those who are in Christ Jesus. Very, very absolute. And if you want to know how absolute it is, this word udeis is placed as the first word in this sentence. First word. To the Greeks and to the scholars, when you want to emphasize a point, you take the word and put it right up front. So if you read this verse in the Greek, it is this, udeis, ara, nun, katakrima, and so on and so forth. No. That's the first thing you need to understand. No, never, not at all, will there be any sentencing or punishment for your sins to those who are in Christ Jesus. Absolute. Let this thought soak in for a while. Because this is what man often thinks. Man often look at God as if he's the God of gotcha. You know what's the God of gotcha? I gotcha. You sin, I gotcha. You know, we look at God as if he's like inspecting our lives, and any moment we sin, he's going to whack us like a fly. Have you played this game before? Whack-a-mole? You go to arcade and amusement parks, and children love to play whack-a-mole. The mole comes and pack, pack, and you whack it. I'm really bad at this. And sometimes we think God is very good at whack-a-mole. Oh, all he specializes is to look at Christians when he sins, whack him, punish him, tekan him. Whack-a-mole God. God of the gotcha. But no,